Okay, so let's get started. Welcome to the Winter Quarter Informatics Seminar Series. I'm Yunan Chen. From this quarter, I'm taking over. I'm the organizer for the seminar series for this quarter and next quarter. And for those of you who are in my 209S class, you should be getting the flyers and class syllabus from me. If you're not in the class and you're interested in the schedule, we should have the flyers everywhere on the fifth floor. So check out the schedule and make sure you come to the talk on time. So for our first talk in the winter, we have our own Paul Dourish, and he's going to talk about spreadsheets in organizational life, and in particular about materiality of information. I believe this is part of your new book.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to introduce the whole career of Paul, and we all know him. His work has been very influential in HCI world, and he's highly cited, and many of you have taken classes with him. So I will leave this with you.
Okay, thank you. Don't be so sure. wait till the end. So I've given a couple of talks in this series before over the last few years about this project that I've been working on around the materialities of information. That's a project that, if not reaching a conclusion, is reaching a waypoint at the moment, because just at the weekend, I shipped off to MIT Press the last thing I have to ship them for the book that I've been working on, which was the index. Writing an index is always a fun way to spend a weekend. So what I'm going to do today, is focused on a series of case studies. As a sort of larger argument, it was anchored by a series of case studies. What I want to do today is talk through one of those case studies, which is around spreadsheets. It's chapter 4, for those of you keeping track. I'll also set the context for the larger project. So some of you might have heard a little of this stuff at the front before, for which I apologize. I especially apologize for the fact it may not make any more sense this time than it did that. But it's sort of useful to have some of that sort of broad context. So yeah, the larger project I've been doing under this label of the materialities of information. In particular, the materialities of digital information. And this seems on the surface to be a somewhat contradictory notion, I think. We're used to account of the immateriality of digital information, the visual invocations of the virtual and of digitality are things like this, a barely embodied person, and a whole lot of like ones and zeros. The other curious thing about these is they're always blue. I don't know what it is about big data and about the virtual, is that apparently the world has decided that the virtual is blue. And so in the context of that, in the context of a whole series of notions that the contemporary moment is one in which atoms have been displaced by bits, and in which we have dematerialized all these sort of objects in order to encode them inside our digital systems, an investigation into materialities, physicalities, materialness, seems somewhat contradictory, perhaps. But in fact, not only are we familiar with a variety of ways in which the digital is material, but there's many different kind of routes into this that we could imagine taking, and that different people working in different kinds of disciplinary areas have done. There are many different things that the materialities of information can be. We could start off, if you like, with a sort of material culture argument. So in anthropology, which has traditionally been deeply concerned with symbolism and with the sort of the semantic, with notions of meaning and the way they're embedded and circulate within culture, a group of anthropologists working under the label of material culture have investigated the ways in which those kinds of symbolic meanings are deeply carried by and woven in with the physical fabric of the world, the physical fabric of objects that we carry with us. Whether that is the durability of denim, the permanent luster of gold, the fragility of heirlooms and what that means that they mean for us and so forth. We can think about materiality and symbolism and semantics being sort of deeply bound up. And in exactly the same way, one route into thinking about the materiality of the digital and materiality of information is to imagine perhaps how it is that different kinds of objects, digital objects, become invested with different kinds of meaning, significance, symbolism, and power. How obsolescence works. Why I had to go out and buy a whole series of new dongles for my new MacBook. And how the kind of the dynamics of shifting and change. I've used this slide for a while. I realize with every year I have to, like, it's more likely I have to explain. So this is the Zune logo, Microsoft's iPod competitor that this fellow was so proud to display. So I used to call this slide, like, you know, why iPods are popular and Zunes are not. So that's one, you know, material aspect. Another material aspect with which we're sort of can be deeply familiar is the materialities of the ways in which information manifests itself in our world. The idea that in the early 21st century, your proximity to high-speed networking may be as important as your proximity to the freeway was in the previous century, or the railroad in the century before that. This is a photograph I borrowed from my colleague Genevieve Bell, taken somewhere in the northern part of South Australia. I can never tell if this sign is a warning or an informational sign, but the part I particularly like is the tire tracks swerving around the road, perhaps in response to this sign, perhaps not. There's a lot of strange things you find in the roads in Australia. So it's materially woven in with the infrastructure of our world. Another materialist account is perhaps that, a sort of Marxist materialism, that is an examination of what it takes to be able to put together information systems, to construct environments within which they can operate and from which they can spread, to be able to wrestle these sort of economic and political conditions together in order to produce the kinds of digital effects that we're all familiar with and through which we operate all the time. So there's not only sort of like, you know, materialist in the sense of like physical objects, but also materialist in the sense of that sort of like, you know, historical materialism that's required in order to produce the sort of the contemporary arrangements of our digital world. And then finally, you know, we could also sort of like look at some sort of combinations of these and the ways that that digital systems take on material appearance in our world. This building, if any of you are ever wandering around in downtown Los Angeles, this building, One Wilshire, confusingly, it's not on Wilshire Boulevard, it's on South Grand, but it's opposite the end of Wilshire, and is one of the most wired buildings in the world. It's an internet packet exchange. It's one of the largest internet packet exchanges in the U.S. It recently set a real estate record for the L.A. downtown core, because essentially what matters is the volume rather than floor space. Almost nobody actually works in this building, although we know that some people from the NSA work in this building, but otherwise this building has a lot of wires coming into it and going out of it. It's where the inter of the internet happens. It's where all those different networks get plugged together, especially in a very bizarre, oppressive room on the fourth floor of this called the Meet Me Room, which where, you know, you have a hard time walking down the corridor without getting strangled by yellow monomode fiber. So there are many different sort of materialist manifestations of the digital, but most of these, I'm going to argue, are actually, with the exception perhaps of the material culture stuff, most of these are examinations of the materiality of information infrastructures. And I'm less interested, for the purpose of this talk, in the materialities of infrastructures, important though they are. I want to think a little bit instead about a different kind of materiality, a different way in which digital systems manifest themselves for us materially. And I'm inspired by a phrase from the design educator, Donald Schoen, who talks about design as a reflective conversation with materials. And I find that a very evocative phrase. Now, Schoen was talking largely about the kind of physical design, the crafting of artifacts, crafting of form associated with, well, I don't know, perhaps potters and wheels. And one can imagine, you can take that phrase and you can imagine its relevance here. You can imagine how you could think about a potter casting a pot, throwing a pot, as being a reflective conversation with materials. You push on the clay pushes back. Certain things work, certain things don't. You have an artistic vision in mind, some of, you know, which maybe can be realized through this clay, and maybe it can't. And there's sort of like a conversation going on there, right? I'm trying to produce some kind of effect. The material accepts some of what I want to do with it. It resists other aspects of what I want to do with it, and we sort of move back and we move back and forth. So it's a conversation with materials that he claims is central to design, or that he wants to argue is central to design, and in fact, as uses it as a definition of what design is. And I sort of want to ask the question, given that we are deeply invested in notions of design within informatics, HCI, and allied disciplines, what is the material with which we are having a reflective conversation in the digital? And the primary, so the primary, my primary focus is on digital representations. Because I think that we do have an understanding as programmers, as designers, as interface developers, and so forth, of a similar kind of reflective conversation. You have an idea in mind that you want to realize in a piece of software or through a particular kind of tool, and then you discover what ways in which that can and cannot be realized successfully within this tool. Yes, I can, you know, pretty much write a program to do anything, but some programs work better than other programs. Some of them are better suited to particular kinds of computers than others. Some things I want to achieve are better suited to some kinds of tools that operate in particular kinds of ways. There is similarly to the clay, the stone that's being carved, or the wood that's being carved, and so on. Similarly to those, we also have this reflective conversation with materials in the digital, but those materials are different. Those materials are sort of representational. I think, you know, one familiar example for lots of us in HCI or cognitive science, anybody who studies sort of external cognition and distributed cognition, very familiar with this kind of example. That is, that we teach grade school children simple rote mechanical procedures for doing calculations, arithmetic calculations. But those procedures are based on the manipulation of Indo-Arabic numerals. And, you know, the positional system, the decimal system that we're all familiar with. If I presented you with exactly the same arithmetic operation, but I present it in the form of Roman numerals, you're at something of a loss. The only way we really have to deal with that is to translate it back into the decimal numerals that we can work with it, and then translate it back into Roman, right? There's no positional system here. The glyphs don't necessarily have singular meanings because the glyphs on either side of them will transform what they mean. There are no rote procedures for us to apply. It's just not possible for us to work in quite the same way. The numbers are exactly the same, but the representational systems have transformed the effectiveness with which we can work with them. So we have here this notion that representations have these sort of material consequences, and I really want, in this case, to push it to a material consequence, because it really is to do with where things are on the page, how they can line up or be lined up, and the consequences of that. Some of you might be familiar with work by Thomas Green, Marion Petrie, Alan Blackwell, and others around what Thomas originally called the cognitive dimensions of notations. And this is a line of work that's pursued this idea about the consequences of particular kinds of representational forms in the realm of programming languages, and especially how people learn to write computer programs. And what they looked at were the kinds of problems that people would have, that novice programmers would have, and the difficulties that they had in different kinds of programming languages, and identified the ways in which many of these problems, many problems that one has when learning to program, are conceptual problems. Many of them are learning the operational structure of the computer and so forth, how it operates. But many that they found were also simply problems with manipulating the representation on the screen, manipulating the notation on the screen. And they discovered that different kinds of languages would produce different kinds of errors and different kinds of bugs, different kinds of conceptual slips would be made through the difficulty of manipulating the representations themselves. You know, if you want to add a parameter to a function, so there's a question of simply how many places in a piece of code you have to touch to do that, right? One conceptual change in your head, potentially 500 keystrokes, you know? If you want to refactor a piece of code, if you want to change the order in which operations are performed, is that a simple chat change or a complicated change? Exchanging the order in which two of these lines happen in a piece of Java code like this is really easy. Changing the order in which operations will happen in a prolog program, which is where what you do is you sort of express the structural properties of outcomes rather than the sequence of operation, is very different. And so they sort of identified the way in which these kinds of problems are tied not to the conceptual operations of computer programs, or indeed to the behavior of the computer program once it's running, but to the notational properties of the programming language itself. And they detail, I don't know, 8 or 9 different kinds of cognitive dimensions. And it's really kind of interesting work. But it ties draws our attention again to a way in which a computer program operates not simply as a conceptual structure in our head, but also as something that sits on a piece of paper or on a screen that has to be materially manipulated in the sense that it can be difficult to make the manipulation work successfully. That moving things around, that there's like, you know, there's the material arrangements of how things actually appear on the screen. So this is sort of the broad setup here then. I'm interested sort of like throughout the project in different kinds of materialities associated with digital information and information representations. I don't want to simply say materiality, that is, that it is material, because I don't find that particularly interesting, although I think it's true. But I'm interested instead in materialities, that is, the ways in which the particular kinds of materiality that different kinds of representations exhibit. And just like the physical objects exhibit different kinds of materiality, robustness, weight, heft, so too do digital representations. I want to talk through some of those. I want to talk about it today in the context of a particular example, which is spreadsheets, and especially one particular sort of use of spreadsheets. While I was preparing this talk earlier in the week, I came across this perfect example. I've not embedded the video, but you can go look for it if you like. A rather bizarre, perhaps, example of the materiality of spreadsheets. Has anybody seen this? Mm-hmm. This video, this is a person who sets out to open an Excel spreadsheet and solely by pressing the down arrow button, scroll to the bottom of it. All 1,048,576 rows of it. He does it not by holding down the button, but actually by repeatedly pressing the button. He does it in one go, which takes 9 hours, 36 minutes. The fact that he's got a bottle of like 5 hour energy on here, I think is significant. And if you choose to, you can watch the entire nine and a half hours. I think he was somewhat surprised just to get to the bottom, but there actually is, it turns out there is a bottom of the spreadsheet. And it's like, you know, that's a fine place to hide things, I suspect. So certainly for him and his keyboard and his poor index finger, the spreadsheet has certain kinds of like, you know, material consequences, but that's not what I'm particularly interested in today. I'm interested in settings like this. And in work that I was doing with Melissa and with Janet Vertesi and with Matt Beats and some other folk on the Cassini project at NASA, we repeatedly came across settings like this. And indeed, once we recognized them, we realized that we live in them a great deal of the time as well. So here's a group of people gathered in a room. The U of tables, people sitting around with their laptops, and projected at the front of the room onto a screen is a spreadsheet. And the spreadsheet contains the data to be worked on today, and the work of the meeting is to manipulate and manage this spreadsheet. What they're doing in particular is they're trying to decide which of a variety of technical options, scientific options for the next phase of the mission they're actually going to engage in, because they know they can't do all of them. The particular thing with this one was that was amusing to us was that the goal of the meeting was to go yes or no for each of the options that they had. And if it was yes, the spreadsheet would be colored green, and if it was no, the spreadsheet would be colored red. And you can indeed see some green and some red on here, but there's a whole lot of yellow, and there's a bunch of blues, and then there's things, the greens that are not quite as green as that green, but like, not, but a little less yellow than that one. They found themselves, as they started to go through, unable to make the strong decisions that they wanted, and using all sorts of properties of the spreadsheet to be able to sort of represent their ambivalence about different kinds of options. I became fascinated by this for one reason in particular, which is you can't sort by color in Excel. Now, actually, it turns out it's not quite true. You can group by color, but you can't sort by color. So in fact, the commitment you make to particular kind of colors, one of the interesting things about this color thing is that it can't be operationalized. It can only be worked on by people looking at things, right? And I find that kind of fascinating. The fact that the ambivalence is allowable within the framework of the spreadsheet seems to say something important, and I'll try to sort of get to a little bit about what that is. Now, events like this seem to me to happen all the time. I live through a great deal of them. Conference meetings, where program committee meetings, where you're deciding what kind of what papers are going to get accepted and put into the conference. Graduate student admissions. I hate to tell you, graduate students, but this is you've all been sales on spreadsheets projected at the front of the room at some point as we try to decide, like, you know, what how we're going to like craft a class and admit people to the program. There's a lot of these kinds of meetings go on. And yet they seem to have had very little attention in the scholarly literature. What there is a lot of is studies of this, studies of PowerPoint and people giving talks. I was giving this talk once and somebody took a photograph of me with my hand in pretty much exactly the opposite gesture. It was like, or the same one. It was like, so I've got this photograph somewhere of that slide on the background and then me in front of it talking and gesturing. But I should have put that on, but it gets a little insider. There's a reasonable amount of work on PowerPoint, and the work on PowerPoint is really pretty interesting. So there's work that people like Wanda or Orlikowski and Joanne Yates have done on sort of genres of organizational communication and how PowerPoint structures organizational communication, both in the performance, in particular kind of meetings. What kinds of things can you do, can you say, can you argue with PowerPoints behind you, as well as in the way that PowerPoint slides might and decks might like move around in organizations. I used to do a lot of work with Intel. Intel's standard document format for everything is a PowerPoint deck. It's not Word. If you do your performance appraisal at Intel, it's a PowerPoint deck. If you do a project proposal at Intel, it's a PowerPoint deck. And you have to imagine those slides that get sent up the line get worked and reworked, and I take one from this and one from that and put them together and become other kinds of talks. They're never actually presented. No one ever like puts your performance appraisal on a screen and stands in front of it and talks to it, but nonetheless, the PowerPoint deck is the unit. So there's work of that sort, about how it moves around. There's some nice work on how, that's something different, no, Brian, I'll come to that later. There's some really nice work by this guy, German conversation analyst called Hubert Knobloch, who's done a lot of study of what he calls PowerPoint events. A person standing at the front of a room with PowerPoint behind them giving a talk. And he analyzes in different kind of details, different levels, you know, how what I say is interspersed with the points on the screen, how I have to turn around to point at things and then turn back, how I tell whether you're looking at the screen or not, stuff on the structure of the slides, stuff on how a room has to be laid out in order to allow it to be PowerPointed, right? PowerPoint that happens, so forth. So there is some work on PowerPoint. There's very little work on spreadsheets. And in particular, very little work on this idea of spreadsheets as things that are projected at the front of the room. All of the stuff that there is on spreadsheets, there's sort of like there's two bodies of work. The first one that's pretty interesting is stuff on spreadsheet errors, which are numerous. In some studies, something like 68% of spreadsheets have errors on them. Now, I mean, spreadsheets is essentially a form of end-user programming for people with no debugging tools. And some of these can be tremendously consequential. So some of you may know the huge debate that grew up over an error that somebody found in the spreadsheet of published research in economics, which research was the primary academic argument for the introduction of austerity policies, like throughout the world, but especially in the EU and especially in Germany and Greece, but also in Britain. And it turns out that the numbers that show that austerity policies work are wrong because somebody had dragged out the column incorrectly and missed off a whole bunch of countries off the bottom of the spreadsheet. And if you correct the spreadsheet, the numbers come out very differently. So it's a huge, some of these things are like, that's life and death stuff, right? Those things are very significant. So spreadsheet errors, there's some work on spreadsheet errors. There's some other really nice work that's gone on in organizational science that looks on spreadsheets as sort of like repositories of organizational knowledge. That is, that when this year I want to do graduate admissions, I start off by going to the spreadsheet that we had last year that gave me a structure for doing things, and I get rid of all the content, but I still have the structure there. So, you know, I'll talk a little bit more about that idea in a minute, that spreadsheets become, documents become records, records become structures, structures become habits and patterns, and then we do them all again. But I want to talk in particular about these kinds of what I'm calling spreadsheet events. Because we found these to be very common in the organizations we were studying, and as I say, sort of reflecting on our own experience, we recognize very many of them. And you want to think about, what is it about the structure of the spreadsheet that makes it an effective tool for doing this job? And in the spirit of like Knoblauch stuff, I want to sort of draw attention to the fact that the spreadsheet is manifesting itself in multiple places at once. It's not just on the screen at the front of the room. And yet it is importantly on the screen at the front of the room. It's not enough for it simply to be on everybody's laptop. It also has to be this organizing, central, orienting artifact for us. So I want to think about the materialities of the spreadsheet that lend itself to these kinds of uses. Okay, so what's a spreadsheet got in it? Well, I want to think about it in terms of three things. I want to think about it in terms of the grid and the formula, which are the two principal organizing features of a spreadsheet. And I want to think about it in terms of trajectories, which sort of speaks to this idea about what spreadsheets as objects, as digital objects, can do. So the grid is the central and most obvious feature of spreadsheets, the spreadsheets that we use. The spreadsheet, we talk about the spreadsheet now as a digital object. The spreadsheet was originally a pre-digital object. It's large, and it's gridded, right? And it's the kind of sheet on which you used to do economic calculations, which Bob Frankston and Dan Birkeland realized could be turned into a computer program, and they did this mid-VisiCalc, and it became the killer app for the Apple II. But what is central to the spreadsheet in all its manifestations is this, is the grid. The important thing about a spreadsheet is it's never blank. It's only ever empty. And the point about the difference there, the point about it being empty rather than blank, is that it already comes committed to a particular kind of arrangement. There are structures to the way in which data can go in. I can't put it just anywhere. Every data item has to be somewhere in particular, and it has to be somewhere in a grid that automatically embeds it with relationship to other kinds of elements. I can manipulate the data. I have very limited abilities to manipulate the grid. I can stretch it out. I can shrink it. I can't make it three-dimensional. I can't decide to go off-grid for a while, at least not in most spreadsheets. Apple's numbers has a sort of interesting sort of difference. It has multiple grids. But by and large, you're stuck with that. And that means you also tend to be stuck with the granularity of the data in the particular way that you organize it at first. It's really hard to refactor a spreadsheet. It's pretty much impossible to refactor a spreadsheet. Whatever you decide at first and work with as the granularity of data, as the idea of what a single datum is, a single item that lives in a particular kind of part of the spreadsheet, you then become committed to that in a way that, I mean, you basically pretty much have to like rip that whole thing up and start again in order to make a change. So granularity really matters here precisely because of the commitment to structure that it implies and the temporalities, the dynamics of a spreadsheet over the course of its lifetime, which again matters particularly if we think of that sort of notion about how spreadsheets get reused later. So the grid gives us this kind of, gives us a structure around, you know, that our data has to sort of fit into. But it doesn't just do that in the context of these kinds of meetings. Because the grid is also an anticipatory structure. The grid anticipates how it is a meeting will progress. You could go to one of these meetings and they start at A1 and then they go to D17 and then you come to like E2 and then it's like bed, you'd probably like, you know, call a halt to that meeting pretty quickly or just leave the room. By and large, the way that one works with the grid in these kinds of settings is from top to bottom or from left to right, or perhaps top to bottom a little bit and then bottom up and then so forth. But nonetheless, the grid and provides a structure of anticipation. I know what we're doing now in the meeting, and I also know what we're about to do. I can, in a program committee meeting, for instance, anticipate roughly how long we've got until we get to discussing one of the papers that I have a particular opinion about, because I can see where we are with respect to what's going on. Whether that's a grid that we're working through as they are here, or whether it's a grid that you're filling out, there's a sense that the structure is not only the structure of data, but it's also the structure of interaction. It's also the structure of the social meeting that's going on. And the grid, to the extent, again, that it provides a framework within which things happen, that the things that happen within the grid also start to matter for how they can be woven into the structure of the social interaction. Think again of this issue that I can't sort by color. I can't move through the grid in terms of color. I can't automatically move to the next slightly less yellow thing. Except by us all like looking at it and saying, where should we go next? So the grid doesn't provide, it provides an anticipatory structure, but only within particular kinds of limits. The next thing that's important in these meetings and related to that idea is that the grid aligns things, but it doesn't combine them. It keeps them separate. So a lot of the meetings, and especially this meeting that we looked at first that sort of inspired some of this stuff, that meeting, as I said, was in order to decide what kind of science could be done the next time the spaceship went bust in Enceladus or something like that. And the problem was there wasn't going to be as much time at Enceladus as they had thought, and there wasn't as much fuel as they had hoped. And so while they'd had a plan to do a bunch of work, it wasn't all going to be get to be done now, and we had to decide what work could we still do and what work were we no longer going to do. So everybody had to submit their proposal for which was the most important work that they had wanted. And where everybody here is different teams who run different instruments, the magnetometers and the ultraviolet spectrometers and so forth, they've all got different kinds of different requirements, different needs for some of the time on the planet. And they all have to propose these things within the same structure. So the way to think about it, and this is actually not quite what's going on in this slide, but never mind. Way to think about it is each team gets to submit a column. There's a structure that says, here's the various things we might need to know, and you give your column. Here's our most important thing, here's our least important thing, here's the criteria that we're applying, here's what it's going to cost, here's how much money it's going to take, here's how much time it's going to take, here's how much of the pass I want, here's how much fuel it's going to need, here's how much delta V it's going to need, here's how much the reaction wheels are going to have to move, and so forth. Everybody has to give it in the same structure, but the point of the columns is that they align those things, they bring them together, they show how everybody has the same needs in response to the same questions, but without combining it, because it's really important that we keep these separate, because this is a fight. And these people are not agreeing, and the way things worked in the Cassini project is about making people equally unhappy, not necessarily equally happy. And so the idea of this alignment But at the same time, separation is critically important in the grid. The grid allows everybody's position to be represented, to be made visible, to be independent, to be manipulated in its own right, but without having to like collapse that into a narrative. You know? A narrative might emerge out of what happens in the meeting, but it doesn't go into the meeting. So alignment and separation, holding things together but not too close, is incredibly important in the spreadsheet. And again, it goes to the way that I can manipulate a grid in a slightly different kind of manner than I can manipulate its content. Okay, so much for grids. The obvious other thing that spreadsheets have, or at least most spreadsheets have, many spreadsheets have, some spreadsheets have, all spreadsheets have the capacity to have, formulae. Now, a lot of the use of a spreadsheet that I make, there's no formulae at all, right? It's just like lists of things. But for many people, formulae are also an important part, right? Formulae are the things where I can say, at this point, I would like a summary, or I want to know the average of all these things, and I want the sum of these ones, and I want to know like what's left over after I do this, and whatever. So I do this sort of like mathematical thing whereby some cells have contents that I don't enter directly, but rather are computed automatically from the contents of other cells. So there's these primary cells that have content themselves and derive cells, if you will, that have content on the basis of something else. This is what makes it more than a matrix. This is what gives me more structure than the grid does by itself. But one of the things that's important or intriguing to notice is the fact that the spreadsheet, by and large, hides from me the difference between those two kinds of cells, the derived cells. There's no, and the primary cells, there's no visual distinction to be drawn between cells that have numbers in them and cells that have formulae in them that manifest themselves as numbers, except perhaps by how they change when something else happens. But visually, it's completely indistinct. You might argue that it's because it doesn't actually matter. As long as the number says 10, I don't care whether someone typed in 10 or whether they multiplied 5 by 2 to get there. But it does matter because it speaks to something about, again, anticipation, how one expects the spreadsheet to be used in the future. I always want this number to be the multiplier or the multiplicand of these other two. I always want it to be the result. And so I need to know how it is that it's going to be used in the future. It's a commitment to a particular kind of expectation that something might change. It speaks to the ways that some things must remain stable and other things must be able to change or subject to change. And so we start to see within even just, again, the structure of the grid with the addition of the formulae, a commitment to certain kinds of temporalities and a notion of change, of malleability, of those things that are important and stable and those things that might remain open. And that matters with respect to the sort of dynamics of how spreadsheets and other kind of documents move through organizations. Because again, if I take my spreadsheet from last year's process and I remove the content, I remove the numbers and the text, but by and large, the structure remains the same. The formula structure remains the same. What I say is, there's still going to be the same things that are important for understanding what class of graduate students is. The same things are still going to be important for understanding the spread of papers included in a conference. The same things are going to be important for resolving the dispute between different space teams on the Cassini project, even though the details of the particular students, the particular papers, or the particular science work are going to be different. And that matters because of this idea of how things move and spread through organizations. It matters, too, for what we think about as being one of the primary features of electronic documents, which is automatic summarization, automatic searchability. I can't search for the number 10 if the number the file, if the number 10 has actually been generated dynamically on the basis of two other numbers. You can search about it once the thing's open, but you can't Google for it. And that math, again, so it becomes significant that the things that are on the screen are not necessarily the same as the things that are in the document, in the file. And that mattered for the people at NASA. And it mattered because they were also concerned about how these documents would move around. Spreadsheets were generally not created in the meeting. And they were generally not discarded at the end of the meeting. Spreadsheets come into meetings, and then they move out again. Maybe I circulate something ahead of time in order to gather information from the different space, from the different like instrument teams, and I collate it. And then that's the thing that comes into the meeting. Or maybe we start the meeting by saying, well, where were we last month and where we are we this month? Well, let's bring up last month's spreadsheet and see where we are now. Similarly, the purpose of the meeting is to come to some kind of conclusion. That conclusion's represented on the spreadsheet. The spreadsheet's going to go somewhere. It's going to go to someone. It's going to get filed somewhere. It's going to get labeled with the date and recorded as, here's what we did on Tuesday. Here's what we did when we had that particular kind, that particular meeting. So flows suddenly become significant trajectories of the spreadsheet as an object. I'm going to come back to this in a second because in terms of some distinctions between the spreadsheet and other kinds of objects, but they flow. They have a particular kind of, again, sort of granularity, a particular kind of versioning structure by dint of the ways in which spreadsheets are organized as digital objects and organized into these kinds of like organizational processes. As things that happen at particular kinds of moments and in particular kinds of places, as things that represent the commitment that one part of an organization makes to a particular kind of course of action. And then similarly, as I said, there's this case also of the way in which last year's spreadsheet becomes the basis of this year's action. Our process for doing something has become embedded in a tool, in this tool, and so the structures of the tool then create the limits similarly of the structure of the process. So it's useful to think a little bit then, in the context of, for instance, the meetings in NASA, about, in order to try to sort of like focus our attention a little more on the particular materialities that spreadsheets offer, why spreadsheets in particular rather than other things? There's many things I could have projected on the screen. If I want to make a case for doing a particular kind of work, I could have PowerPoint in the front of the screen. We could use a word processor, and we've sat in meetings where people have word processors open in the front of the screen. You could just be drawing it on the whiteboard. You should be keeping this stuff in a database. There's all sorts of different kinds of ways you can do things. But these different kinds of arrangements don't necessarily suit the particular way in which this sort of organizational work is being done. The spreadsheet allows for change in a way in which PowerPoint does not, at least in the way in which we normally project PowerPoint. PowerPoint comes, again, sort of like committed to a particular kind of narrative structure, whereas although the grid anticipates, it doesn't constrain, and we can work on the spreadsheet together. The spreadsheet has that sort of property of, again, alignment and separation, which a textual document would not allow. Certainly, I can use a word processor and put a table in it, but like pretty much the only thing that makes me want to poke my eyes out with a stick even more than using Excel is using tables in Microsoft Word, so let's just not go there. Whiteboards, the whiteboard certainly allows for that kind of, like, you know, gridded operation and so forth to a certain extent, but the whiteboard can't move out of the meeting in quite the same way. I can take a photograph of it and send it to it by email to someone, but it can't then be the basis of future work in quite the same way that the spreadsheet does. Many of the things that we do in spreadsheets on grids could be recorded in a database, and there's lots of ways of using spreadsheets as databases. One of the interesting things about the database, though, is it doesn't have the kind of versioning granularity that you want. I can make update a record, one of 10,000 records in a database, and you would never know, right? It's hard to know that, it's hard to see it. Whereas when I take a spreadsheet and I make a copy of the document, I duplicate it, I rename it, the granularity of versioning there is actually tremendously important. The spreadsheet as a whole has its own kind of identity, whereas at a particular moment in time, databases don't exhibit the same kind of temporal identity, temporally robust identity that spreadsheets do. One of the ones I became really fascinated with, and I was like, going to like just go back quickly to one of those photographs, is the notion of an online document. In particular, this is like, why are they always have Excel and not, say, a Google Doc, including a Google spreadsheet? We could do that too. Why did they not do that? And I think what was going on was, in particular, when you have this arrangement, One person is in charge of that spreadsheet right there. There might be copies of it on here. You make a change on your laptop, I don't care. This is the gold master copy. This is the one that matters. This is the one that came into the room. This is the one that's going out of the room. This is the one that's going in the organizational record. This is the one that's getting emailed to the boss later to say, this is what we decided. What's more, when that's the gold standard, the only way that can change is visibly in front of everybody. You can't edit a cell that isn't currently on the screen, right? If this was an online document, these guys could be doing all sorts of things to that spreadsheet at the same time, and you'd never know. You don't want that to happen. You want there to be a singular point of visible change and activity. And what's more, you want that point of singular change and activity to be controllable. I want it to be my laptop. You are not editing the next slide so like to confuse me. You're not changing the spreadsheet. So I actually think that there was that Excel in particular here, and this is not so much a spreadsheets versus non-spreadsheet, but Excel as a particular kind of spreadsheet had, again, a particular series of material properties that committed it to particular kinds of use that made things like Google Docs and online tools less useful for this particular group. So this is, just to wind up, what I'm sort of trying to draw attention to here are not just, this is, again, not just materiality, but materialities. That is, I'm not simply saying, oh, look, it's a thing. It takes up space. It consumes power. You can only fit so many of them on a hard drive, wherever. It's rather to begin this project of teasing apart what the different kinds of material configurations are that that particular kind of digital representations display, and to understand something about the consequences that those have for how we encounter data, how we work with data, how we experience it. To head something off, one of the things that has frequently happened when I've given this talk or versions of this talk, talked about this word, is there's always somebody who says, aren't those affordances? and the answer is, well, the answer is very complicated. But they're not. And in particular, there's a couple of things. I mean, the first thing is that I think the term affordance has gotten so horribly overused that it now has no meaning at all, and so I just don't want to like wallow in that pit. Or wade into that. I was going to wade into something, but I wallowed in it. Sorry. I just don't want to go there. But the other thing is, the thing about affordances is it's very important in Gibson, is affordances are properties of the world that afford action to appropriately equipped individuals. Affordances are a relational term. And I really want to draw some attention away from relationality here, much though I'm committed to relationality as a sort of like, you know, conceptual tool. But nonetheless, this is not about our relation to these things. This is actually about the properties that the objects have. And similarly, by doing so, we can also sort of tie in to a bunch of other kind of literatures where a number of people have taken materiality as something that they want to sort of examine themselves. We can talk more about that, but I always feel the need at some point to say, no, not affordances. But there are, of course, importantly here, critical relationships to practice, to the way in which we work with things and the ways in which they hold meaning for us through the limits and the capacities that they offer. So in the book, I go through a sort of series of cases of this sort, spreadsheets, chapter 4. There's some stuff on emulation and simulation. There's some stuff on databases that I think I've spoken about in this seminar series before. Some stuff on network protocols. And they sort of, you know, they draw from different disciplines and they operate at different kind of scales. But this is sort of like the central concern, this concern about moving from an understanding that things are material to examining the ways in which their materialities manifest themselves, what kinds of materialities they have to offer, and with what kinds of consequences. And then the slide I've never been able to use before is, it actually has a cover now. So the book is due out, I believe the official publication date is January 28th. We should have a big launch party at CHI. Okay, hopefully we have got some time for questions before we go downstairs. All right.
Steve. I'd like you to meditate on the fact that online documents can be locked down in such a way that only the owner does it even as other people's cursors crawl across it, and whether this doesn't imply that people are in some senses more trustful of the physical thing in front of them than the fact that there's a potentiality up there that if I put it up there, even if I lock it down, other people can be looking at it.
Mm-hmm. Would you like me to meditate on that out loud? Or shall I just?
No.
Absolutely. So you're absolutely right, and it's not clear that we can really safely generalize in the way in which I was generalizing. I was intrigued by why it was that this particular group of people weren't making use of a tool that you might think would be of value to them, and I do believe that question of you're right that we can lock things down, we can effect the same kind of control with an online spreadsheet that they were doing with Excel. But the thing about their form of control that they had was that it was very visible, very easily understood, and sort of distributed into the architecture of the room. It didn't require configuration. It didn't require potentially getting things wrong. It didn't require figuring out what all the different levels of permission were going to be. Nor, perhaps more importantly, did it involve anyone having to negotiate that. Because I don't want to get into one of those meetings, and especially not those meetings with Cassini, and then have someone say, hey, why don't I have permission to edit this column? I'm a senior scientist on this project. I should have that. And you just don't have to do any of that shit. So I think that's actually an important part of this too. But it's not, you're absolutely right, it's not as if one couldn't either configure some existing tools to do that, or imagine configuring, you know, being able to configure tools to do that. It's not about the sort of broad capacities of the thing in itself, but I do think that was part of what was going on in that meeting, and it does draw some attention to the idea of the spreadsheet events in the normal
sense. And that's
sense.
What I was hoping you would say.
Oh, I got the right answer!
No. I mean, along the lines of, in some sense, it's stuff, like, stuff is hardwired, and it's no longer flexible.
Right.
And thank
yep.
you.
Yep. All right, thank you.
Maybe relevant to that also is that there are the type of meeting, I wasn't in the meeting obviously, but the type of meeting implies that there's a leader, there's a central focus of attention,
right,
we're
yeah.
all talking about the same cell of the spreadsheet at the same moment.
Yeah.
Whereas that collaborative document, maybe the format of the meeting might be, we're a group of five equals all working on a project together, and we'd like to all be able to be off doing something else.
And we certainly like saw those kinds of meetings going on too, where a bunch of people from different kind of things would come together to like solve some problem, and it's like everyone's focus doesn't have to be like laser-like in the same place at the same time. But yes, absolutely. So I think there's that sort of configuration of problem, setting, group, and tools.
Yeah, but in each case, it's creating, it's
a different, it's a different, it's a different.
Says we're going to work this way. Right.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Have you sort of looked at the ways that people use Excel with other systems? Like, for example, I know a lot of people, I used to work for Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab, which is kind of part of NASA, and like taking screenshots of Excel sheets a lot and then moving that to something else. So have you looked at that?
I haven't. And the primary reason is that we weren't actually studying spreadsheets in this particular case. We were studying other stuff that was going on and happened along the way to like have noticed and gotten intrigued by the spreadsheets. And yeah, they're sort of interfunctioning with all sorts of other things, including, I mean, I would sort of include here like projectors and screens and walls. It seems like a worthwhile sort of like area. I did say this project is not over without a waypoint, which is the publication of the book. There's still plenty of good things to do, but I haven't looked at that.
Do you think the spreadsheets are here to stay just in general, just because like the properties you say that make it like a social adhesive for properties of organizational life? Because I worked for two internships for two startup companies, and their vision, their mission statement was, get rid of the spreadsheets. We have this tool. This is what you need to use for everything. So
I certainly think that having get rid of spreadsheets as your vision statement is going to stand you in good stead. Because like no one's going to go, no, don't take my spreadsheets away, please. I mean, I think it's also the case that these genres evolve, but they're also remarkably stable, right? So they evolve, but only within limits. The spreadsheet as a form is not just like, it doesn't just go back to like 1972 in Brooklyn or whatever, 1977, 78, you know, but it goes back to 1778 or 1578. I mean, it's like, you know, ledger systems of that sort, which have many of the same kind of properties or things that have been around with us for a long time and sort of interfunction with how arithmetic works, with how language works, with how our writing instruments work and so forth. So, you know, I am entirely, I'm certain that we will evolve past spreadsheets of exactly that sort. Numbers on grids seem like they're going to be with us for a very long time.
Hey, thanks for a great talk. That was very interesting and also very funny, which I don't think of in a scholarly talk.
Or you don't think of the spreadsheet.
No, I think of nothing but that. But I guess this is maybe a kind of, this is a loose question, so maybe we'll just give you a chance to kind of jump in here. But I'm thinking of this way in which you have described materiality as materialities, as in plural. And I'm thinking of its implication that there is still a V spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so I'm just wondering if maybe there's a way to think about not, I guess I'm starting to feel skeptical that there is a V spreadsheet, or wondering if maybe there are ways it could be productive to abandon the singular spreadsheet. And
right.
So I'm wondering if maybe materialities are in fact different versions of materialization as some kind of ongoing process that
so
can happen
that, yeah.
along different vectors.
Right, and I think at different kind of scales, and that's the yeah, exactly.
It's a kind of phenomenon of materialization.
Yeah, I can certainly see that.
It lets us maybe abandon this object that we keep looking for.
Right. There certainly, I totally agree that there are many spreadsheets in the sense of the many different kinds of encounters with them and uses and ways in which they get enrolled, and indeed, I remember, I just think, I made the comment earlier about how like my spreadsheets never have formulas in them, although I think that's actually an example of the many spreadsheets. But I also remember the occasion of like putting together a program committee with someone and they like opened up their laptop and started a spreadsheet. I'm like, why would you have a spreadsheet? It's like, I just use spreadsheets for lists. And it's like, it never occurred to me to do that. So there's like many in that way and many in their embedding in different kinds of forms of practice. And I think you're right that the materialities speak perhaps to different kinds of encounters between practice and the object, or the objects. I do think, though, that it's that question of sort of scale. If you want to think about sort of a temporal scale, like that at which these different kinds of things evolve, some of them live alongside each other. Some of them are evolutionary practices by which new kinds of imaginaries arise for the digital objects that we're playing with. So I think you could move back and forth between the plurality of materialities and the should never have started down that one again, and those of the digital objects. But I'm not quite sure yet how to best sort of like put those together. That's a really sort of productive line, so thank you.
So the one thing that came to mind too, I when thinking about spreadsheets, that didn't actually come out in your talk, but I think it's kind of also there, is what is the role of spreadsheets in sedimenting authority
right.
in some way. So there's these flexible practices, and those who are in the room can engage in the flexible practices. I've seen in budgeting processes where people go in and they like make the numbers work, you know, and they're literally messing with the spreadsheet to try and kind of get the outcome they want. And as they do so, they're getting further and further from their initial ideas going into the meeting. But once they leave, that becomes a sedimenting.
It becomes,
authority.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. And that's the one of the interesting things, of course, is that it retains no history for how it came to be the way it is. It simply is the often authoritative record, and it is the object of record in many of these meetings.
And the grid
as well.
Does that too.
Yeah, 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 yeah. It's like because it allows for certain kinds of multiplicity, but rigorously
mass
cuts down other
exactly.
cuts down others. So yeah, that's a really good point. Okay.
We should first thank Paul for a really great talk.